This episode of the Old Dogs REI Network is brought to you by Mino Studio.
In a world where jobs are how most people make money, one man, one desire, one challenge dares to break the mold. Welcome to the Old Dogs REI Network, where we don't work for money. Money works for us. Coming soon, viewer discretion advised.
Welcome to the Old Dogs REI Network, where cash flow is king. Real estate investing, the means, so you can enjoy your retirement dreams. This is the show where we cut right to the chase. No sales pitch, no long monologues, just simple how-to real estate investing advice, so you can earn the passive income you need to enjoy your retirement today. And now, your host and chief old dog, Bill Manicero.
Welcome to the Old Dogs REI Network. I'm your host, Bill Manicero, and this is a show where 50-plussers and anyone else who wants to join us get solid and no sales pitch real estate investing advice to help generate real cash flow. This podcast airs twice weekly on Mondays and Fridays, and if you aren't already a subscriber, go to iTunes, type in Old Dogs, spelled D-A-W-G, find our podcast, and subscribe. Well, we have a show here that I am totally stoked about. This is going to be fun. We have a gentleman here who is an expert in long distance real estate investing. And those of you that have listened to the show know that that's all I do is long distance invest. And it's no coincidence that he's also in California, where it is not so great to invest. But nonetheless, his name is David Greene, and he is a name that may be a name familiar to you, especially if you're familiar with Bigger Pockets, because he's one of the co-hosts there. He's also the author of a book called Long Distance Real Estate Investing, How to Buy, Rehab, and Manage Out-of-State Rental Property. He's also an online blog contributor. He's Keller Williams Rookie of the Year, a top-producing real estate agent in Northern California. He is also a police officer who started investing in real estate in 2009. And David has built a portfolio of over 30 single-family homes, as well as shares in large apartment complexes, mortgage notes, and note funds. That sounds like a topic for another interview here. Well, David teaches free monthly seminars on real estate investing and has been featured on numerous real estate-related podcasts. He runs greeneincome.com, a blog where he teaches others to build wealth through real estate, as well as the David Greene team, his real estate sales team, and is one of the top Keller Williams agents in the East Bay. Well, David Greene, welcome to the Old Dogs REI Network.
Thank you, Bill. You did a great job with my bio. I've never sounded better.
Well, it's a great bio, man. We could zero on anything. We could talk about your police officer activity in the East Bay. That should be interesting. But you know, you're also a fellow, you know, out-of-state investors. I call them out-of-state. You call them long distance. But I am totally excited to talk to somebody about that who's been doing it here longer than I have. And so there's just a lot of great stuff in your background. Plus, you're a realtor and still active doing that. So there's a lot of good stuff here. So, David, I'd just love to just hear your story, you know, how you got into real estate. How did you get involved in this crazy world we're in?
You know, it's funny because real estate is almost my whole life at this point. Like you mentioned, I'm a real estate agent. I sell a lot of houses. I help clients, basically helping them by buying or selling using the same principles and strategies that I use in my own portfolio. And I'm a real estate investor. I host the Bigger Pockets podcast. I write blogs. I just started writing for Forbes about real estate. So it's kind of all that I do at this point. And I just eat, breathe, sleep, drink real estate. But I had zero intention of ever being involved in real estate at all. it really just started with a friend from church who was buying a house and decided he wanted to go to Bible college and was going to lose his earnest money deposit because he couldn't buy the house. And he was talking about it. And I said, well, shoot, man, maybe I can help you find someone else to buy it instead of you. You get your money back. He said, that'd be great. I said, well, let's go take a look at it. We went to look at this house, and this was in, it's in Lathrop, California, which is right in between, it's a little bit south of Stockton, between Stockton and Modesto. And not a wonderful area, but it wasn't a terrible area at all. This was a house that was 4 years old, 2,500 square feet, four bedrooms, three bathrooms. I mean, it basically just needed a vacuum to be run over it. And this was in 2008. So there was tons of properties that were for sale everywhere in 2008. I mean, you throw a rock and you'd hit a for sale sign, there was so much foreclosures. I realized, like, man, this would not be a bad place to buy and rent out myself. And when I'm ready to start a family and I need a house, I'll just move into it. That's all that I was really thinking. So I called the real estate agent and I talked to her about it, and he had it under contract at $215. And I looked it up on Zillow, and 4 years ago, it had sold for $555,000 in 2006, when it was like a brand new construction home, just an absolute complete price reduction. And I thought, based on comparables, $215 was a pretty good price. But they were about to lose the escrow, so I asked her if she could get it for me at a better price. And she came back and said, hey, if you put an offer in today, we can get it at $195. She was
unbelievable.
Wow. Right? And it was one of those REO deals where her broker had the agreement with the bank to sell their inventory, and she was a buyer's agent on his team. So she kind of had the inside scoop. She went to him and said, hey, we're going to lose the deal. It's got to be at $195. He said, whatever. Because at that point, if people remember, it was just chaotic. I mean, prices were dropping $10,000, $20,000 a month sometimes. Everybody was writing offers and then backing out. It was just kind of a bloodbath out there. So they were happy to keep it in contract, and I got it for $195. Had no idea what I was going to do. I had the complete wrong mindset at the time. I thought that I needed to do everything myself. I was a total cheapskate. So I went and bought a Landlord for Dummies book, which, to be honest, I didn't want to buy. I tried to read it while I was still at the bookstore because I didn't want to spend $20 or whatever to buy this book, right? And put it up for rent on Craigslist, put somebody in there. Was very busy working my job as a police officer, so I didn't run his credit. I didn't check references. I had zero idea what I was doing. I just figured if I'm honest with this guy, he'll be honest with me. He was very naive, and it ended up being a terrible disaster. The guy paid rent for the first 2 months, and then he actually ended up stealing money from me and paying me with my own money. The title company had sent my refund check for taxes that I paid during escrow that I shouldn't have, to the tune of like $3,000. To the property address, even though I didn't live there. So he gets the check, he forges my signature, he cashes the check, and he pays me 2 months of rent with my own money. The rent was like $1,500 a month. Okay. Right?
This is the guy that's going to Bible college, did you say?
No.
Okay. No. Okay, the guy that actually...
This is my tenant that I put in the house,
gotcha.
Right?
So okay, gotcha.
I bought it instead of the Bible college guy.
Gotcha.
So long story short, I get the money back because the title company messed up. I evict the guy with the help of a friend because I didn't have anyone to help me do it. He owed me about $7,500 at the end of the day that I never got back. It was a horrible experience. And if I could have sold it at that time, I would have. Thank God the market had not recovered and I couldn't sell it. I had to make it work. So I put it back up for rent again. And one of the people that showed up said, oh, you know, we were just looking at a house next door. Our property manager had sent us there. And I said, what's a property manager? And they walked me through this whole process of there are people that do this for you. And I thought, wow, I should have one of them. So I called their property manager and I just said, I have a house for rent. And they said, oh. And they ended up renting it to those very same people. So, I mean, they didn't really help me find the people. And that wasn't the reason I loved property management. But they just knew what to do. I can't describe how impactful that was, that these guys that were experienced in something that to them was very simple and to me was a whole new complicated world took so much of a burden off my shoulders. I went from hating owning real estate to loving owning real estate with one decision. That hiring a property manager just made it so much better and made me think I could do this again, which eventually opened the door to buying a house every year, maybe two a year in California. And then in 2013, California got to be too expensive and I moved to Arizona. That's where I started my long distance out of state investing program or system, you guess you could say. And then Arizona got too expensive and I moved to Florida. And by that point, I had done it three times and I started to recognize patterns. Every time I go to a new market, I look for A, B, C, and D. And from there, I grow to E, F, G, and H. And I kind of recognize like it's the same thing every time. If I get this part right, all the other pieces will fall into place. And that was how I ultimately ended up writing the long distance investing book.
Wow. And where did you become an agent in that process?
That came way later. So my strategy back then was work 100 hours a week as a cop. I mean, as much as I could possibly fit into my schedule without breaking the rules of our contract for working too much, I was working 7 days a week, 18 to 20 hour days, sleeping in my car for 3 hours, getting up and going to work another shift. It was, I loved real estate investing, and I knew that we were in this golden era of cheap properties with high rental demand and really low interest rates. I knew I might never see a market like this again. So I really just wanted to buy as many properties as I could as a single guy without a family who could kind of take some financial risks by buying properties. And I did it as a police officer. It wasn't until, God, like 2 years ago, probably, so 2016, that I realized this is unhealthy. I'd gained a lot of weight. All my relationships had just kind of faded into the distance. I didn't do anything but work and buy houses. And I joined a group called GoBundance, and it was kind of a wealth building accountability group. And the guys in the group were telling me, you're way too smart to be a cop. You need to be doing something else. You should be selling real estate. It's much easier. Kind of started a lot back and forth in my mind between should I or shouldn't I. And I eventually opened up to the idea of getting my real estate license. I stopped working overtime as a cop. I just worked my regular 40 hours and I started selling houses and kind of learned the process that way. And then ultimately, I took a leave of absence from being a police officer. I had nothing else to do, so I went to work as a real estate agent. And all the information that I had compiled by investing in real estate gave me a huge leg up over all the other agents in my life. And I just voraciously studied the business of being a top producing real estate agent. What matters? How do you find business? How do you do a good job? How do I out negotiate the competition? How do I help my clients understand what they're getting into? A lot of it is psychological work. I would love it. Like, investing is very cerebral. You make the numbers work. It's very simple. Being an agent is much more complicated because you have the financial number side of it and you have the emotional side, which is much trickier to try to control. And that's how I became a real estate agent. And now I'm in this beautiful position where there's a lot of synergy between being an agent and selling more houses. So I have money to invest, buying more rental property. So everyone knows me as the real estate guy because they see all the houses I'm buying. And then that gets me more business as a real estate agent. And then I get better at it. And I'm kind of in this, like, we call it a virtuous cycle where one hand is helping the other. And it's really becoming a nice little niche for me to be known as the real estate guy. I started hosting the podcast at Bigger Pockets. I wrote the book. I've got another book coming out in May on the BRRRR Method. We could talk about that a little later. It's one of the ways that I buy rental property where I get all my capital back. And it's especially important to people who don't have a lot of money. Like, maybe if you're not a spring chicken where you've got 30 years to save up money, you've got a nest egg and you need to make the most of it, the BRRRR Method would be really good. But I love being a real estate agent. I never thought that I would like it because I hated sales, but you're not necessarily a salesperson as a real estate agent. I'm not at a used car lot waiting for someone to come walking up and trying to convince them to buy a house. You're much more like a sports agent who's representing their client, trying to get a better contract for their team, trying to get them more money. And those were the skills that I learned investing in real estate. So it's fun to be able to use it for other people that would otherwise have zero opportunity to benefit from my knowledge because they're not going to know. They don't do it themselves. And they're just hoping they get a good agent. The people who work with me, they can know this guy does it himself. He knows what he's doing.
Wow. Now, do you represent any real estate investors or is it just your typical folks looking for the first home, second homes, and that kind of thing?
You know, I thought I would work with a lot more investors than I do. In California, and I'm sure it's the same for you, it's very difficult to find good deals. Our markets are just very competitive. Real estate investors are looking for a house that nobody else wants. That's how we get a really good deal, or a house that nobody else has seen, you know?
Right.
When you're working with clients, because everything's online now, they're looking at houses constantly, and it's very hard to find something that other people don't already know about. And if you're an investor, it's harder to find a deal on the MLS than it would have been at other times. And it'll go back to where it was easier than what it is right now. So I end up working with more people just wanting to sell their house, buy a house. What I do help people with is connecting them with agents in other states that will help them find investment property. because I am an agent, I now know and network with the top agents in the country who are really, really good. They can help you build your team. I call it the core four in the book, that will help you find deals, that will help you run numbers. People don't have to just hope that they find a really good agent. I can connect them with somebody who knows what they're doing and can kind of guide them through the process. But I don't work with them nearly as often myself. I think when we have another recession and the market corrects, I'll be working with a ton of investors at that point. But at this point, there's really not a lot.
Interesting. Interesting. Yeah. Generally, you know, people will ask me as well, you know, well, should I get my license? Should I not? In a lot of cases, I hear kind of the pros and the cons. I know investors that, you know, that they're definitely a little bit limited, especially in the state that they're buying in and selling in as an investor. But, gosh, you know, knowing what commissions are in California, I mean, you could sell a house and buy an apartment in another state.
That's right.
No, right. I mean, seriously. I mean, and the Bay Area, that's like got to be the highest, one of the highest priced areas in the country. I mean, that's like crazy. It's almost like, yeah, the best of both worlds here.
If you can do it right, I think the part that catches people off guard is it is extremely hard and competitive to find clients as a real estate agent. I did not understand. HGTV doesn't show that part, right? you think you're going to be showing homes and negotiating contracts, and that's bill like 10% of the job if you're good. 90% of the time, you are beating the bushes to find somebody to let you be their realtor, convincing them that you're the best option. Trying to find them a deal that they don't actually end up buying. So if you can navigate those waters, it's a great way to make a living if you already love real estate. A lot of people get into it thinking that they're just going to have people who want to sell their house and they just call them out of nowhere and they get very disgruntled. And there's actually a lot of fees that are involved in it as well. What I tell people is if you're a student of real estate and you love it and you're a hard worker and you're willing to do what it takes, get your license and do both. Because like I mentioned earlier, there's a synergistic quality to selling houses and buying houses yourself where each one helps the other to do better. If you know you're not a person who wants to study everything they can about real estate, they just want to buy a house, have some passive income, and it's kind of a small piece of their life, don't step into these waters because you'll be more frustrated than it's worth.
Yeah, I would imagine a pretty big chunk of your time is on just marketing and developing to attract potential clients, I would think. That's got to be huge.
That's almost all you're doing. And you don't realize how many other people are real estate agents until you get into it. I mean, everyone we know knows 8 or 9 different agents. And you're trying to be top of mind to all of them. And you're competing with the Zillows and the Realtor and the Redfins of the world who are trying to convince people agents are useless. You don't need one. Go with us and we'll discount your commission. And they're getting bottom of the barrel, terrible agents that had to go to those places to make a living. So it's hurting the profession. And I'm trying to convince people how I'm going to save you more money by not discounting my commission because you're getting a good agent who can actually look out for stuff where these other ones don't. It's kind of just a messy world to operate in that you got to be kind of heads up in. However, you learn a ton about real estate. Like you have to because you're representing somebody else. And that really will help you. If the more you learn will help you in your own business. It helps me when I communicate with agents out of state. It helps me separate contenders from pretenders. It helps me build skills when it comes to finding people my clients will need. We want to buy a house, but it's a fixer-upper. I got to go find a handyman or I got to go find a person who give us a quote to fix it up so I can give them a good idea what they're getting into. Well, those same skills translate when I'm looking for a handyman in Arkansas, you know?
Right.
And I think a lot of people get into real estate investing thinking it's like stock investing, which is, in my opinion, you're clicking a button and you did a little research on a company and you think it's either undervalued or it's going to go up. Real estate investing is not that passive. It's passive income once you've got it down. But in the beginning, there's some work involved, which is really good because it creates a barrier to entry for other people, right? That's why there's still opportunity in real estate because it's hard. You got to work harder than other investment opportunities, but you have so much more control over your result that, man, once you get good at it, it's like the best thing ever.
Well, you still have 30 houses, is that correct?
I think I'm around 35 at this point. I've slowed down a little bit just because my real estate agent business started doing so well.
Gotcha.
That I wasn't able to keep an eye on the stuff I was buying.
Right.
And things were slipping through the cracks a little too much, and I was just getting frustrated. So, like, for instance, I bought a house and I had a guy that was helping me review the deals I looked at, and he was kind of learning and I was teaching him, and we closed on it before we got back the roof report showing it needed a new roof. Right. $10,000 that I wouldn't have bought that house with had I known. And I just thought, well, I can't really expect this guy to figure this out as fast as we're moving, and I can't look at it. So let me take some time to get my real estate agent business a little more stable so I can put more time into investing. But that's where my passion is. I mean, there's nothing like the rush you get from getting a really good deal and closing on it.
Right. Oh, definitely. And what percentage of those homes are in California?
Oh, not many. I'd say I've got 5 or 6 in California out of the 35.
Gotcha. The rest are all out of state. And yeah. Your license is only for California, right? As far as being a realtor?
Yeah, I can represent people in California for them. When it comes to investing out of state, what I do is I work at Keller Williams, which is the biggest brokerage in the country. And I know just from my network of people that are also investors, people I've met through the podcast, people in GoBundance, who the real players are that are good at being an agent. So when somebody says they want to buy in Kentucky or Indiana, what I do is I connect them with the real estate agent that I know from my real estate agent network who's really good in that area to help them, which is actually, when I wrote the book, I wasn't doing this yet, right? So I explained to people in the book, hey, here's how you build a system from the ground up, right? This is how you go put boots on the ground, people. And now that I have the exposure I have, a lot of those people just come right to me and I connect them with these agents, and it kind of saves them a lot of time.
Interesting. Well, I do want to talk a little bit about that process that you've been referencing here. Is really there are folks that are listening, and some of them have been looking at real estate investing. They're thinking, well, should I do it in my own backyard? Should I do it out of state? And maybe you can just kind of go into the details of how you actually get started as a long distance investor.
So I got started as an investor just because California became too expensive. So what you find is as home prices increase, rents do as well, just because the demand for homes goes up. That's what's pushing prices high. Well, it will push rents higher too, but they don't go up proportionally. The price will go up much higher than the rents will. And that's for several economic factors. You've got the fact that a lot of primary residence homeowners can put down 3% where an investor has to put down 25%, which means someone can pay a lot more for a house if they're only putting down 3%. We'll push the price higher. When rents go higher, it makes it make sense to pay more for a house because even though your mortgage is higher, it's kind of offset by the fact that you'd have to pay higher rents anyways. At a certain point, you realize you cannot buy a property at a price and still have it cash flow unless you put down a ridiculous amount of money, which then hurts your ROI and it doesn't make sense to do it. So we have this concept called the 1% rule in real estate, where if a house will rent for 1% every month of the purchase price you paid for it, it's likely to cash flow. So it's a really easy number to run in your head. If you're looking at a house that costs $100,000, if it's around $1,000 a month for rent, it'll cash flow. If you're looking at a house for $150,000 and the rent's around $1,500, it will cash flow. Once you get outside of that 1% and you get to where properties are like 0.5%, you're buying a house for $300,000 that will rent for $1,500 a month, you're going to lose money on that house. And what I do is I look at which areas fit that 1% rule, and that's where I go invest because that's where I know I can find the cash flow. And as the market gets hotter and hotter, those areas start to shrink, right? Like there's just less and less of them because prices are always going up. And part of being a smart investor is finding the market where you can get a good return on your money and then getting your capital back out of the deal so that when your preferred market eventually becomes an area that you can buy in, like I'm sure you'd love to buy in Huntington Beach or Newport Beach, right? But good luck finding a house that you can rent out. Well, maybe when the market corrects, you can find houses in Orange County where they'll actually make sense because they're priced so low. You want to make sure you have capital to go invest in those areas. And that's kind of how my system is designed, is I want to be able to buy anywhere at any time, but I want to get my money back out so that when California is affordable, I can buy everything that's around me too.
Gotcha. Well, a couple of, I'm going to take a step back a little bit. Once you also mentioned that 3% as opposed to 20 or 25%. Are you referring to like FHA type loans that, are you dealing with a lot of clients that are on FHA homes, home loans?
You know, actually, Bill, you can get a 3% down on a conventional loan now.
Really?
There's a lot of loan programs.
I'm out of touch.
Yeah. So in areas like ours where homes are so expensive, lenders have to find a way for a person who can afford the payment but isn't good at saving money to buy it. And that's most Americans, to be frank. We do good making money and we really spend it. We don't do good saving it. So they have to find these programs for people that have low money down. And I mean, there's some grants that I've used for clients where they put nothing down. They actually got from the federal government 5% of the value of the house in free money to cover their closing costs and their down payment. And they got a house for nothing down with an interest rate that might be a percent higher than normal. And that's all the time now. We're not seeing adjustable rate mortgages. We're not seeing negative amortization loans. Like, I don't want this to scare people and think, oh, we're going back to another crash. They still have to make their payment and the payment's still affordable for them, but they're not putting a lot of money down. And if you're buying a home as a primary residence, you have that option. So what a lot of people do is we have this concept called house hacking. Well, they'll approach me and they'll say, David, I want to buy a house to live in. My rent keeps going up, but I don't want to have to pay this really big monthly payment. What can I do? And we look for duplexes, triplexes, houses with in-law units, houses with finished basements that the person lives in and rents out the upstairs that covers a sizable portion of their mortgage. So they're kind of an investor, but they're getting to buy a house as a primary residence owner with a very low down payment. And they get a little of the best of both worlds. And it's very typical for your traditional, what I call the traditional method, which is go in, put down 25%, then take a bunch of money and put it towards the rehab. It's very hard to compete with these people that can put a really low down payment because they can afford to pay more than you.
Right. Right. Well, you also mentioned you look for markets. I want to look at that area as well, where, for example, they have the $100,000 house for $1,000 a month rental. Mm-hmm. Is there like a one data source that you go to where you can find this information, you know, where it's readily available? Let's say Lexington, Kentucky, you know, you can find the $100,000 house for $1,000 rent. How are you finding that information?
That's funny you mentioned Lexington because I do have a really good agent that I send a lot of people to, and that's exactly what they find in there.
That's great.
I haven't found a data source that does that work for you. I am sure there are plenty of startup companies out there right now with all this cheap capital floating around that are trying to do exactly that. It's honestly common sense. If you understand the gist of how markets operate in America, which I've had to learn because I wrote the book on long distance investing, so I study this stuff all the time. Here's the general pattern that your listeners should understand. Coastal markets, the West Coast and the East Coast, experience the highest fluctuations in price. They go really high, they go really low, right? As you move inward towards the middle of the country, the flyover states, those really big ups and downs slowly start to even out a little bit. So if you start on the West Coast, California goes really high and then it crashes really low. It's very, very cyclical and extreme. You move over one state, you get into like Nevada, Colorado, Arizona, they go up and down, but not quite as much as what California does. You get deeper and you're getting into like New Mexico and you start to see like a very small fluctuation. Goes up a little bit, goes down a little bit. When you get to the middle of the country, the Midwest and the South, it's very, very like steady. It's kind of like a flat line, you know, like when you watch somebody's heart's beating, just it doesn't really go up a whole lot. It doesn't go down. So a market like Indiana, you could have a house selling for $90,000 right now. And I will ask the guy, hey, at 2010, at the bottom of the market, how much was this thing selling for? And they'll say, oh, maybe 82,000 instead of 90. It just really didn't go down hardly at all. And it also doesn't really go up much. That's the best way to look at where you are in the market cycle and where you should be investing. During recessions, I buy on the coastal markets because I know I'm going to get a lot of appreciation when the market turns around. That's your best bet for the long term is buying low in a coastal market. During a high point like where we are right now, I'm primarily in the Midwest and the South because that's the only place you're going to find cash flowing properties. And if you take that very simplistic approach, you're going to save yourself time. You're still going to find deals. And if you use the BRRRR method, you'll get your money back out of the deal so that when it makes sense to buy in the coastal market, you still have the capital to do so.
Let's talk about the BRRRR method while you're on that too, because generally there's rehab involved, right? So you're not buying the sort of the cream of the crop that's out on the market that people just want to move into. Is that correct?
Well, you could, but it's not very likely. Yes, the majority of the time you're buying houses that are fixer uppers.
Gotcha.
And the idea behind it, so BRRRR is an acronym that stands for buy, rehab, rent, refinance, repeat. And I just wrote a book about this. It's coming out in May. Bigger Pockets is going to be publishing it, and it basically details how you do this. But the gist of it is, if you go take a house that's worth $100,000 and you pay $100,000 and it needs $20,000 worth of work, you're going to pay $25,000 for your 25% down payment. Then you're going to pay $20,000 to fix it up. So you spent $45,000 and you've got a cash flowing property. But that's a lot of money. It takes you a long time to save another $45,000. That's the traditional method. And that's what I was doing while I was working as a police officer, working all these crazy hours, saving up $45,000 to go buy another house. And it was killing me. You can only buy, you know, two houses a year, working like a madman. With the BRRRR method, I wouldn't ever target the house that's worth $100,000 and I'm paying $100,000. I target the house that's in such bad shape, it won't even qualify for a loan. It's got a hole in the roof. Somebody was trying to rehab it and ran out of money, so there's no kitchen. The drywall has been kicked out. I mean, it's just like disgusting. And I go pay maybe $60,000 for it, right? And I put $30,000 into my rehab. So I've spent $90,000, but I have pretty much a completely fixed up house. So my capital expenditure, my maintenance will be much lower because I've already fixed it up. Then the house appraises, and let's say it appraises for $120,000. The bank will then let me loan against the appraised value instead of against the value that I bought it for, the price I paid for it, right? Now that it's worth $120,000, I'm getting 75% of that back on a loan, which happens to be $90,000, which happens to be all the money I put into the deal. So I've created $30,000 in equity. I have a cash flowing property. It doesn't cash flow as much as if I just put the huge down payment, but it's still pretty close. And I get all my capital back to go buy the next house. And I'm so passionate about this method because what I find is that most people get into real estate investing, their first deal goes terrible, like I described mine, went terrible. You do a couple more and you start to get a rhythm down. You do a couple more and you start to really like it. And just when you're getting excited about it and into it, you run out of money. Mm-hmm. And then you have the problem of, David, how do I buy deals with no money down? How do I raise money from other people? And you're not a real estate investor anymore. Now you're becoming a syndicator and you're trying to learn financial principles, and maybe you're not a people person, so raising money is harder for you. I just think, and what you've done is you've created a ton of equity in your portfolio, but you don't have any access to that capital to earn you more money. And when I look at buying a house, fixing it up, renting it out, refinancing it, you make money when you buy. We say that in real estate all the time, right? Like every time I purchase a house and then fix it up, I added $30,000 to my net worth in that previous example. The acquiring of assets is the most important part of this cycle of real estate investing. And if you don't have capital to do that, you're removing yourself from what is the most important part of building your own wealth. And that's why I don't like putting these really big down payments down. It sounds much scarier when I'm describing it than when you're actually doing it. All that you're doing is, instead of using the value of the asset when you first buy it, which in my example before was, it's worth $100,000. We're going to let you borrow 75% of that. You're using the value of the asset after you fixed it up, and it's worth more. So you're getting a higher percentage back on the value of the asset, which allows you to recover more of your capital.
Gotcha. So are you, and just to clarify here, are you paying cash for that house outright, or are you actually taking out a conventional loan? And then, because you mentioned refining, so did you take out, so the $60,000 home, you're only putting down what? I mean, 20,000 or something, or to get into that, and then you've got another 30,000 in rehab costs, right?
Yeah, my style is to pay cash. It's just easiest, right? But you wouldn't have to. Yeah. Right. You could use a hard money loan to buy the house, fix it up, and then refinance it into a long-term loan and pay off your hard money. You could use a conventional loan in the beginning. I don't like that method as much because you're going to pay closing costs when you buy and you're going to pay closing costs when you refinance, which is an extra, you know, $7,000 to $10,000. That's a pretty big expense.
Right, right.
And I also target houses that won't qualify for conventional financing, and that's why I get such a good deal.
Well, let's go there right now. Where are you finding these houses that are, you know, that won't qualify? I mean, they're not on the MLS, or are they?
No, a lot of them are. So what I find is that, and I talk about this in the long distance book, there's three forms of distress. And what, as an investor, that's what you're looking for. You want distress. You want some way to buy a house that has something wrong with it, right? So you've got market distress. That was 2010 when everything was for sale. And I said, you could throw a rock and you could hit a sign. That's the easiest way to get involved. But you have the least amount of control over when that happens. We don't control the markets. We just take advantage of them. Then you've got personal distress. This is probably the overall best thing to target. This is the person going through a divorce, has medical bills, unexpected death in the family. Somebody has a house that they don't want to own anymore and they need to get rid of it. Maybe it's a landlord that has a tenant who isn't paying and they don't know what to do. There's a lot of, you know, problems in their personal life and they need to get rid of this house because they need the money. The third method is property distress. The house itself is in such bad shape that it poses a problem to whoever buys it, and you want to be the person that can solve that problem. So that's what I actually target the most, is property distress. I want to find a house that scares everybody else, that doesn't want to put a lot of money into it, doesn't want to put a lot of time into it. It's a bigger project than they want to take on. And I can find those on the MLS in a lot of these markets. As long as you're, I'll give you another hint, is you look for a market that has a high day on market. So the houses take a long time to sell in those markets. If you're in a market where houses are selling in 10 or 15 days of being on the MLS, even houses in bad shape are selling for a lot of money. When you get into markets where houses take 90 to 150 days to sell, that tells me I have a lot less competition, right? And those are the places I want to be. Especially if I'm looking for a house that nobody wants in a market where very few people are looking. That's where I can really find a good deal. And if I'm taking California money or New York money and I'm investing it at a Kentucky or Indiana housing price, now my cash is going really, really far. $60,000 is a lot of money in an area where people make $9 an hour. It's not a ton of money in an area where people make $50 an hour. Does that kind of make sense?
Right, definitely.
So I'm stacking up all these different ways where I'm at an advantage against my competition. And when you add them all together, they result in a really good deal. So there's people that do direct mail. There's people that use, you know, the computer, Google, like SEO, search engine optimization, to find motivated sellers. There's the old-fashioned boots on the ground, grassroots, hey, calling people and saying, I want to buy a house. I still find them on the MLS, but I'm not looking in red hot markets where everybody else is. And those are the people that usually end up the most disgruntled. Like Huntsville, Alabama is very popular right now. Everybody wants to go there. If you're trying to find a house on the MLS in Huntsville, Alabama, good luck. It's like being a guy in Alaska trying to find a date. You got like 20% of the population is women. You're competing with a lot of people to get yourself a date Friday night. You know, I want to be the position where I'm the woman in Alaska, right? Well, I don't really ever want to be a woman, but you know what I'm saying?
I know, just
so you want to go to where you have the value, right? There's not a lot of people buying. There's houses that are in really bad shape. And your money's going to go really far. That'll make your job very easy when it comes to real estate investing.
So are you looking in secondary, tertiary markets more than in, you know, primary MSAs?
Yes. In general, that's absolutely true. Go ahead.
Now you're in California. So how do you have access to MLS in Kentucky, for example?
I have access to the agents in those areas.
Ah, so you got, cause you're, especially cause you're part of the Keller Williams team, right? So okay, so you can get people searching. I mean, are they doing a search for like foundation problems, like a word like foundation problems in the MLS? I mean, you said you're looking for properties that are distressed, right?
Yes. So there's two ways to do it. There's one is I will find the average price point in a market and I'll say, send me every property in this market that's at 60% of your, the price is 60% of the average price, right? So if all the houses are selling for $150,000, I only want to see the stuff that's $110,000 or less. And I'm much more likely to see a bunch of distressed property that way. The other way is you find an agent who doesn't mind looking for you every single day and saying, take a look at this one. It looks like terrible, right? Most investors start there and they're not very serious about buying, and they turn their agent off very quickly because they've got all these people doing work for them, and then they're not spending any money and the agents aren't making money. And then they move on to a guy like me who's actually going to buy it. So in the book, I talk about a very, very, very easy method, and you don't have to be a realtor to do it. You just find a brokerage in an area that's big. It could be anything, Keller Williams, Coldwell Banker, Century 21, any of those brokerages. You call them and you ask for their office manager or their team leader, whatever vernacular that company uses to describe the person who runs the office. And you say, I'm looking to buy distressed housing in this market. What agent would you recommend I use in your office who's really good at this? Rather than you going through the yellow pages and calling 70 people and trying to find the best one, you let this person be your screening filter for you. He says, okay, you got to talk to Jared or Susan. They're both really good. I talk to Jared or Susan and I say, here's what I'm looking for. Do you think you could help me find it? If they say yes, I say, great. I'm also going to need a property manager, a lender, and a construction guy, like a rehab guy. Can you help me find them? If they say yes, I've got a potential good match. And I call that my core four. That's the property manager, the contractor, the lender, and the deal finder, which in this case is a real estate agent. If I have those four people, Bill, I can buy houses anywhere. And they're going to know all the other pieces that I need to do it.
God, that's great. Great information. What would you say some of the disadvantages of long distance investing?
You rely on other people. So you got to kind of have some ability to read character, and you have to be a stickler for rules. So the people that get into trouble with this are the ones who say, yeah, I talked to Susan and she said to use this construction guy. So I sent him $30,000 to do $30,000 of work, and he did about $10,000, and now he's not returning my calls. That is a little more difficult than if it's somebody who lives in the same market as you, because you could track them down a lot easier, right? So in the book, I talk about you should never send them the full amount of money. I actually describe how I write up contract, how I get itemized scope of work. I only send them the first draw, and I have my agent or my property manager or somebody else go verify the work that they're doing before I send them the next amount of money. I never want to be in a position in any form of business where I am hoping things go well. I talk about so many people are just addicted to hopium. They're smoking hopium all the time, right? You find them saying, man, I hope this goes well. If you are saying that, you did something wrong. There should be a system where you can tell this is going to work or this is not going to work. So that's one challenge of it. The other challenge is it forces you to actually operate like a business person. So my co-host of the Bigger Pockets podcast, Brandon Turner, very good investor, awesome guy. He's like a brother to me, but he only invested in his own market, which was Montesano, Washington. Now, Brandon, when a toilet would break, when there would be a dry rot problem, when something needed to be painted, when a plumbing issue would happen, he would go fix it, okay? I, on the other hand, buying in Florida from California, don't have that option. So I was forced to find a handyman that would do that work for me relatively cheap, right? Brandon thought he was saving money by not paying the handyman $15 an hour. But in reality, he was costing himself money because now he's losing productivity on things where he would have made more than $15 an hour, okay? That's another aspect of long distance investing or out of state investing that forces you to be a little tighter. If you're the type of guy who likes to do stuff yourself, you'll be frustrated with it, but it's much better in the long run to put together systems to handle problems for you, and you go focus on working your job as a nurse or working your job as a mechanic and making more than the $15 an hour you're paying a handyman to fix a roof tile.
Gotcha. Now, when you look at markets, you mentioned, you know, just looking at the, you know, sort of the price points there, and then after you find enough, you know, homes that are, that meet that price point, then you look at the rental rates, right? So roughly you're looking at the 1% rule as sort of determining what market you're going into, or you're looking at other factors in terms of things that might be happening in that area that make it a promising market for you.
So that's where everybody starts, is they want to say, well, what's the next hot place? I want to get there first. in my experience of seeing enough people do that, I've determined that just creates analysis paralysis. They're all trying to find the next hot market. And here's the reason why I think people do that. They have a fear of missing out. What they're thinking is, I want to buy a property A or property B. Maybe they're different states. If I buy A, but B does better, I'll lose all this money. But if I buy B and A does better, well, then I'm going to lose all that money. And they get stuck in this this paralysis where they can't make a decision because they can't determine which is the better buy. And they spend all their time trying to find data and statistics and numbers to figure it out when that really just doesn't exist. What I've done is I've determined to use the BRRRR method, which allows me to buy property A, then property B. So I don't look at, man, there's a huge opportunity cost. If I can't buy that house and it's the better house, I'll never forgive myself. I just found a way to buy both of them, right? And if you're buying a house and you're recovering 100% of your capital or almost 100% of your capital, if it doesn't do great or appreciate, you didn't really get hurt, right? Like, it's when you're putting $45,000 into a property and it doesn't appreciate as much as the next one, that really hurt you because there was an opportunity cost there. You could have bought a better house. But when you're getting it all back out and putting it into another property, your own risk is significantly decreased. And it makes it much easier to not worry too much about the next hot market. So to sum that up, I'm much more interested in finding an area where I feel I have a competitive advantage than I am in finding what's the next red hot market before it blows up. I want to know, where do I have a really good agent? Where do I have a rock star contractor? Where do I have a solid network of people that can give me really good advice that meet my criteria? So I've boiled down what I'm looking for in a house to three things to simplify this for me. I want to know I'm buying it under market value. So I want to be all in for 75% of the ARV, which is the after repair value. I want the house to cash flow, and I don't want it to be in a bad neighborhood. That's it. If it meets those three criteria, I will buy it, assuming I have a core four in place that can actually handle the stuff. So because of that, I'm consistently making progress buying houses while a lot of other people are stuck trying to figure out what's the next big thing going to be. And that is a mentality that I believe comes from the stock market. Because you got to pick the stock that's going to rise the most. It's the only way that you make money buying stocks. You got to buy low and sell high, right? Well, real estate offers you so many more ways to make money. You make money buying a house and fixing it up and adding value to it. You can't really do that with a stock because you don't get any control of the company. You make money from your cash flow. You make money because that cash flow is protected through depreciation. You make money from paying your loan off every month. You make money from inflation as your property value goes up and your rents go up every single month. There's a ton of ways I make money in real estate. So the odds of me picking the next red hot market are much less important than in other types of investing. Like, am I going to buy Bitcoin or am I going to buy the other coin? That makes sense.
Who's your number one most critical person in that market then?
It's your deal finder. That's the most important part.
And who is, I mean, to me, it sounds like it's your agent contact.
It's usually an agent, but maybe it's a wholesaler that you know that sends you their best deals first, right? It could be a bird dog you have. It could be someone who's like, man, they're an attorney and they're constantly dealing with probate sales. And they have all kinds of people who come and say, man, grandma just passed away. We need to sell our house. And he says, I know a real investor that'll buy it from you cash in 10 days. Doesn't care the condition, right? Typically, your agent is the deal finder, but it doesn't have to be an agent. The reason they're the most important is not just that they find you the deal. It's that they're the most likely to find you the other three members of your core four as well.
And you say you're looking at two houses when you're looking at a deal, right? I mean, so is it another house in that market, or it could be in a totally different state?
Could be in a totally different state, could be in the market. That was more of an example to illustrate how when people have a hard time making a decision, it's usually because of opportunity cost. That's what's causing them to hesitate with, should I pull the trigger and move forward with this or that? And if you use the BRRRR method, which is a little bit more work up front, but a much bigger payoff in the end, you can eliminate some of that analysis paralysis.
Gotcha. So you've been doing this for a while here. I mean, you've obviously since 2009. I mean, you're 10 years into this. What would you say was one of maybe the biggest mistakes that you made that you've really learned from?
This is going to surprise some people. In 2009, when I first started buying, I was a single guy with very few financial responsibilities. I live way beneath my means. I had a very stable job working as a police officer, which also had unlimited upside. I could work as much overtime as I wanted. There was no reason for me not to be taking risks, right? And I talked myself into thinking buying real estate was really risky. So I would only buy one house a year. I would put massive amounts of money away in reserves. I was way more conservative than it made sense to be. And I thought I was being safe, but I actually cost myself a lot of money. If I'd have bought three houses a year instead of one house a year during what I knew was one of the best times to ever buy real estate, I would have made another, God, probably $1.5 million just from buying two houses a year more, as much as those things have gone up over time. So my biggest regret is that I listened to fear when it wasn't supported by any kind of facts. I never encourage people to just jump in without doing due diligence. You need to understand what you're doing. You need to understand as many different ways this could go and have a plan in place for how you protect yourself in each case. But if all your bases are covered and you're still not taking action, you are literally costing your future self a lot of money. That's the thing that I think was the biggest mistake I made. As far as practical things are concerned, there were a few times where I bought houses from a wholesaler instead of a real estate agent and didn't realize I needed to do a little more due diligence on my own. So I bought a house that was in a flood zone and I didn't know it. The wholesaler's not going to tell you that. And I didn't even know I needed to check for it. So I ended up with $150 a month of insurance, more than what I thought, which cut my cash flow in half. That one sucked pretty good. The case of buying the house that needed a new roof. Right? Like having other people helping me without taking time to train them before I threw them into the fold. I had another house that I lost my earnest money deposit on because I bought five or six at a time and I literally forgot I bought this one. And I went past my inspection period and they said, hey, send your money to close. And I realized, oh, I forgot about this house. That address does sound familiar. And I sent a home inspector out there and it was just in terrible shape. I never, ever, ever should have been closing on it. So I lost $5,000 there. Those are the majority of the mistakes I made. If you look at the pattern, it was that I was just moving too quickly. But if you look at all the money that I made from moving quickly and putting deals under contract, it's definitely the way to go. I was better off moving fast and losing a little bit, but gaining so much more. And the thing that makes real estate unique is, God, if you can hold it for long enough, it is so hard to lose money buying real estate. Just, I don't know that I've ever met an investor that's had a house for 30 years or 20 years that said, I wish I never would have bought it.
Mm-hmm. That's true. That's real estate. You know, it's a long-term game. I mean, you can, if you're buying it on speculation, yeah, you can lose money, but overall, it's always going to go up. It's always going to go up. So
absolutely.
I totally agree. I just had a curiosity too. Do you buy within like a self-directed IRA or 401k account?
You know, I never really put money into those because as a police officer, we have a pension. So I didn't need to build one of those. I just put money in a savings account. What I do sometimes is I'll borrow money from other people, pay them a rate to use their money, and then I'll go use that money to buy houses. And then when I refinance it, I'll pay them off or I'll roll it into the next deal. Once you've done it a handful of times, there's a lot of money out there, Bill. Interest rates are so low. You're not going to get any money on anything in the bank at all. There's people that are really thirsty for yield, and if you can make them feel safe because you know what you're doing, it's raising money is probably easier now than it's ever been.
What would you say your biggest success is in looking at your whole career so far in real estate investing?
I think the fact that most of us look at cash flow when we want to buy a house. We're like, I want to buy a house to build cash flow so that I can have money coming in and not have to work. And that is a benefit of real estate. I don't think it should be at the top of the pile like most people put it. In my opinion, your cash flow is basically a defensive metric. That's how you know you won't lose the house because it generates money all the time. You're not going to get rich very quickly building up $200-$400 a month on properties. You have to own a lot of properties to make a lot of money that way. And that's a lot of work. It's kind of an inefficient way to try to build passive income. I'm much more proud of the fact that while my properties do cash flow, I don't spend any of that money at all. I put it right back into the business. I concentrate more on building equity. I'm way more interested in buying that house for a lot less than what it's worth, fixing it up to make it worth even more, and getting my capital back to go buy another house. Because like we mentioned earlier, real estate is a get-rich-slow game. I want to own that property for a very long time, let it triple, quadruple, quintuple in price, refinance it a few times to buy more properties, pass it on to my children, or take all that equity and convert it into an apartment complex someday, which then does provide you really good cash flow. And I think more investors need to be thinking long term. How do I build equity, which I can convert to cash flow later, than short term, which is how do I buy a house to make myself some passive income so I can quit my job in the next 2 or 3 years?
Good, good point. Well, you know, our audience are primarily folks we call 50 plusers, right? That 50 years of age and older. Some are approaching retirement. They're kind of really looking at retirement in a very serious way and assessing whether or not they're going to have the funds that they hope they would have to be able to have the kind of retirement that they've always dreamed of. And then you've got those that are already in retirement right now that are dealing with the day-to-day stuff. Both of these groups are looking at real estate investing as a means to be able to generate cash flow, to generate long-term wealth, and hopefully to create a legacy to hand down to their children. What advice would you have for them based on your experience? What would be a good way to start later off in life?
Two things. The first is pay very close attention to your ROI. When you are on a shorter time span, you need to get a lot more bang for your buck. If you're putting $45,000 on a house down, you better be getting a lot of cash flow. I would highly recommend learning and understanding the BRRRR strategy, because if you've got $100,000 saved up that you want to go invest, if you invest that money one time at a 12% return, that's $1,000 a month. It's not going to get you too far. You want to take that $100,000 and buy several houses the way I described earlier, over and over and over, where you're only leaving $5,000, $10,000 in every deal so that you can make it go as far as you possibly can. If you're 25, it's not quite as important to get as good of an ROI because you got another 25, 50 years of growth, right? So you can kind of have a larger margin for error or a smaller ROI. When you don't have as much time, every deal you need to look at quite a bit tighter and maximize your capital. The other thing is, just because you're retiring from one job doesn't mean you have to retire completely. I would recommend people find something related to their passion, which if they're listening to you right now is very likely real estate, and find a way to earn money from doing that. Being a real estate agent might be a really good calling, right? It's very low stress for those kind of people. They don't need a ton of money. They just want to supplement their income. They like talking about real estate anyways. They like teaching people about real estate or being around it. Maybe being a loan officer. Maybe just being a person who runs a real estate investing meetup and connects people and gets paid for making the connection, or plays a role as the hard money lender. I mean, there's a ton of different little roles that people play in making a transaction work. And each of us are unique and have things that we're going to be drawn to that we like more. If you create a world that you can live in and be around all these different people and find how your skill will help them make money, you can make money too. So that's something else. Like, just being in that circle will bring more deals your way, but it also allows you ancillary ways to create income that isn't just buying a house and living off the rent.
Great advice. Well, what are your plans, so to speak, for the maybe the short term and the long term? You're in like so many different places. You're in broadcasting. You're doing the Bigger Pockets thing. You've got your realtor, business. You've got your investing, and you're still a cop. And so, I mean, what's sort of your long term play here?
I have two main goals. The first is I want to become the top real estate agent in the Bay Area of California, which is mostly driven by the fact that, in my opinion, the majority of real estate agents suck. I've rarely ever had a good experience one before I was one. I think a lot of people feel the same. The more people I can help, the more I can provide an option that I can say, look, you can't complain. This guy's really, really good. People that I know can be protected. The other is to provide continual real estate investing for free or as cheap as possible. I am not a fan of the gurus who charge you $50,000 to teach you their system and get you all pumped up emotionally and psychologically and then give you stuff to do that 98% of people are never going to do, and they lost $50,000 and got nothing. I really like the mediums we have today, like this one, this podcast, YouTube channels, where people can get education. And of course, like, if you're paying for somebody's time, you're going to pay money for it. I'm not against coaching. I pay coaches to coach me. I have people that pay me to coach them. That's different than to pay $50,000 for this course that I'll give you type stuff. So I would really like to continue to grow my influence within the space of free real estate education and pointing people towards the fact that we live in a world that's very uncertain. We don't know that Social Security is going to be around. We don't know that our government's always going to run the way it has. We don't know the economy is always going to be as good as it is right now. We need to take responsibility for our own financial well-being. And real estate, in my opinion, is the most solid, surefire, safe way to do that, that you don't need a rocket scientist type degree to accomplish.
I agree with you 100% on that one. Well, we are at the close here. There's a tradition we have here. Actually, it's called our wrap it up session. It's kind of like a lightning round type thing.
Okay.
And I just ask you a series of quick questions, and you just share resources that our listeners can benefit from. So if you are ready, are you ready to wrap it up?
Let's do it.
All right. Favorite real estate book, I'd probably have to say other than your own.
Ooh, favorite real estate book. I would say Brandon Turner's the book on rental property investing.
Oh, I love that one too. That's great. Favorite business book?
So Good They Can't Ignore You. Beautiful book.
Good one. Good one. How about most valuable website for success?
BiggerPockets.com.
Yeah, hands down. Favorite app?
Ooh, favorite app for real estate business or just in general?
It could be just that helps you in any number of ways.
It's called Mortgage Calculator Plus. It's extremely easy. You punch in a principal amount and an interest rate, and it tells you what your payment would be. But I use that little sucker like 6 times a day, running numbers very quickly in my head for potential investment properties or helping clients understand if you buy a house in this price range, your payment's going to be about this much.
Great. How about your favorite quote?
It's a Bruce Lee quote, and he says, "I do not fear the man who knows 10,000 kicks. I fear the man who has practiced one kick 10,000 times."
I love that. That's a great quote, man. All right. And our final question here, if you had to start all over, let's say you had lost absolutely everything, and you really, I mean, everything's gone. All you've got is $1,000 in cash in your hand. What would you do with that $1,000 to try to relaunch, regrow your real estate investing business?
I would use it to create or pay for a space to hold a meeting. I would invite as many people as I could and give them free content on what I do, how I do it, what I'm good at. I would have them all sign up so I have their emails, their phone numbers, and their names. And I would start systematically contacting them. And all I would say is, what do you need? What do you need help with? And I would slowly start solving problems for other people, helping them as much as I could, and waiting for that to come back to me through reciprocity. And I think in a very short period of time, I'd have all my money back.
Wow. That's great. Great. It's the first time I've ever heard that. That was really good. Wow. Well, I'm sure there's a ton of people listening that would love to talk to you, or at least find out more about you and what you do. What is the best way for folks to reach you or to find out more about you?
So if they go to davidgreenrealestate.com, there's an E at the end of Green. People miss that sometimes. I've got a little questionnaire on there that asks people what they're interested in. So we're putting something together where when they basically say, yes, I want to know about this, or no, I don't care about that, we can then send them resources on all the different ways I can help. I also run the blog greeneincome.com. If they want, they can check out that. All the articles that I write for Bigger Pockets, Forbes, the podcasts I'm on, the deals that I do, I put the information there. And I'd love for everyone to subscribe to the Bigger Pockets podcast. Very similar content to what you do here, very similar audience base. I eat stuff up. I listen to about 3 podcasts a day. I'm constantly trying to learn as much as I can. And if you're interested in real estate, that's exactly what I recommend, is you just absorb as much as you possibly can from as many good teachers as you can, and your brain will start to feel a lot more comfortable with what we're talking about over time.
Wow. Well, David, this definitely ran longer than I promised you. Don't hold that against me. But we're going to have you on. In fact, I'm going to try and book in advance here when the BRRRR book comes out that I want to have you on, because we touched on it a lot here. But there are so many people that are just killing it with that method. I really would love to have you back. Or otherwise, I'm going to hold you on for another hour or two here, ask you more questions. So.
My pleasure. You can email me at davidgreene@kw.com for anybody who wants to follow up with any questions. I'd love to be on here again. I think that you're a great host. And as a fellow podcast co-host, I can sell that you're good at your job. You did real good, Bill.
Oh, well, thank you, David. I appreciate that. But we're not done. And okay. If you've ever listened to the show, you know, we do have a tradition that is just longstanding here, and we are called the Old Dogs REI Network. So everyone who's been a guest on here, it closes with a closing howl, and your best old hound dog howl. Brandon, he did it, Robert Kiyosaki. Okay. So, everybody does it, it's kind of like you don't get to leave unless you get to howl.
Your way out of here. So does it have to be a howl or can it be a bark? I mean, what kind of a dog are we talking?
Up in the Bay Area, I don't know what they have, in terms of howls and dogs and stuff, but, almost like a wolf type howl, but you're kind of best dog howl.
So I'm going to have to pretend that I just bought a deal. I put it under contract. I closed on it. I got myself a great deal and I'm excited, right?
That's correct. Yes, that's a great howl.
All right.
Followed by yes.
Let's go eat this thing up.
Well, David, it has been a blast having you on here. I can't thank you enough for coming on.
Thanks, Bill. Pleasure was mine. Hope you guys have a great day.
Well, thank you. And I also want to thank all our old dog listeners out there, too, for joining us. I know there's a lot of other things you could be doing right now, but the fact that you've taken the time to join us means a lot, and we greatly appreciate it. Please note, everything we talked about here is going to be accessible in our extensive show notes that can be found at olddogsreinetwork.com/blog. And you're going to look for the episode with David Greene. Well, that's the show for today. Remember, cash flow is king and real estate investing the means. Until next time, keep moving forward and may God bless.
Thank you very much for visiting the Old Dogs REI Network. We would greatly appreciate if you would stop by iTunes and let us know what you think of the show. We would love if you could subscribe to the podcast, give us a 5-star rating, and write a review. The more ratings and reviews we receive, the more visible the podcast will be to others. Thank you.